Good morning, everyone. I hope you guys can hear me well. This is Pastor Sean Lee from Minneapolis, Minnesota. Hope all of you guys are doing well. Happy Monday, right? Are you ready for this Monday? We had a really good rain here in Minnesota, and I hope you guys had a good rain too there. Like I said, my name is Pastor Sean Lee, and I serve Southview Seventh-day Adventist Church in Minneapolis, Minnesota. So we're neighbors, right? Well, I'm in the Vikings territory, and you guys are in the Packers territory. But we're friends, huh? Even in my church, we have like maybe half of them are Packers fans and half of them are Vikings fans. So whenever I make a football illustration, in my sermon, I always to make sure that one Sabbath the Vikings are good guys, the other Sabbath Packers are good guys and stuff like that. But yeah, we're friends, we're neighbors, and it's really good to be here this morning. And I've been seeing you guys, how you guys been doing on online. Just awesome that all the churches in metro area, you guys can come together. And yeah, good morning, everyone. I have four people or five people saying hello. What was I saying? Anyways, yeah, I've been watching you guys, how you guys been doing and handling the situation. Churches come together and have this fellowship on online. This is awesome. We don't have it here in Minneapolis. Hopefully we will have in the future. But yeah, this great, I'm witnessing this great thing happening in your area. I just want to cheer our pastors there. Pastor Myung, by the way, is my friend. We went to middle school, high school, college, and seminary together. And it has been the case where he was always pastoring church, my neighboring conference. So yeah, we're like good friends, and always good to see him. And I'm privileged to share the message this morning. Why don't we bow our heads as we begin? Dear Heavenly Father, this morning I'm going to be sharing just simple message that we need to find joy in you through the reading your scripture. So Lord, please be with us and fill us with your spirit. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Certainly, it is a challenging time, right? Wherever you are in the United States, I don't know how you guys are doing in Wisconsin, Minnesota. The governor changed the rule a little bit. It was stay home, and now it's a safe home or something like that. But still, we're all going through this difficult time together. The real question is, how do you find joy in times of trouble, right? I think Paul challenges us all the time in this verse in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, 16. What does it say, if you know? Rejoice always, right? How can we do that? And he goes on, next verse, pray without ceasing. Keep praising God, keep being rejoicing, and nonstop praying, right? And furthermore, he says what? In everything give thanks, no matter what. And he further goes, he said, this is the will of God. What we see a lot in the Bible is that we're taught to be joyful, right? Like, Paul himself, he was in prison, but he said, rejoice always. But it's quite challenging, just be honest. In what ways can we be rejoicing? I think Wisconsin must be the same story here in Minnesota. Like, as a pastor, I see a lot of people struggling emotionally towards the end of February. I always get calls, like people are having this interpersonal relationship problems and stuff like that. And some tensions is growing. And few years later, I realized maybe we don't have that much sunshine and people are struggling, emotionally. How can we find joy in time of troubles, right? Or maybe you wonder, when talking to Paul, hey, Paul, what's wrong with you? How can you say something like that? We find people in the Bible, they're joyful. They're joyful in the time of trouble. We see a lot in the book of Revelation who endures tribulation, but eventually they're joyful at the end, especially when they see the glorious coming of Jesus Christ. And at the same time, we see a group of people who will be terrified, terrified, they're trying to hide themselves in the cave, in the rocks of the mountains, when Jesus comes in Revelation chapter 6:15. Don't we think that we should be joyful? We should be feeling like this, finally, Christ is here. But there are some people who wouldn't feel that way. Therefore, we may infer that maybe joy doesn't necessarily come when we have good or happy incidents around. We can be joyful anytime when things are hard. On the other hand, the most joyful thing that we can ever imagine, like glorious coming of Jesus, can be happening, but we may be feeling terrified. You see, our emotions, you know, it can be joy, it can be, you know, you may feel anxiety, can be filling our hearts, but they don't really rely on the tangible incidents that happen around us. It really relies upon our perceptions. We can be joyful in a terrible time when we see the hope behind the things that we can see. You maybe feel depressed or anxious even if we're surrounded by good things in this world, when our hearts know these things cannot give us anything meaningful. Once again, my brothers and sisters in Milwaukee, how do you find joy and peace in times of trouble? So I talked about Book of Revelation, people, you know, who will, you know, this is a prophecy, people who will be seeing the second coming of Christ. There'll be two groups of people. And what about looking at the first coming of Jesus, like how people reacted when Jesus came for the first time? I think we all love Christmas story, right? I love Christmas story. I don't know about you guys. I love those Christmas feeling and the music and stuff like that. And you know, there are many people who heard about coming of Christ in those times. You know, Christ, the Messiah, the promised one from the time of Genesis, like this is the promised one. He's coming. And we easily think that must be exciting moment for many people because this is the promised Messiah, right? But we see different reactions from people. So today I want to show you some kind of different groups of people who reacted different ways. I think we all know what kind of reactions that they had. First example is Zacharias and Elizabeth. You all know them. They're the parents of John. And Bible describe them as what? These people, they are in Luke chapter 1:6, they were righteous people. They were all walking according to the commands of God and ordinances of the Lord, blameless. Here's a big word, blameless. Awesome people. And these people, like when Zacharias, when he encountered this angel in the temple, I mean, he was a little bit fear, you know, he had a little bit of fear, but later he was filled with joy about hearing this coming of the Lord, especially when he named his son as John, right? Elizabeth, when she had visit from Mary, you know, when she walked into her door, and she said in Luke chapter 1, like, how come, why is this granted to me? My mother, the mother of my Lord, should come to me. For indeed, as soon as the voice of your greeting sounded in my ears, my baby lifted my womb for joy. Exceeding joy filled with their hearts when they had Christ and hear the word, hear the good news. What about the story of the shepherd? Right? When Jesus was born in Bethlehem and you know his mom, there's no room, so Mary laid him in the manger because there was no room for them. It's kind of a sad story. But at the same time, angel appeared to this shepherd saying, you know, hey, Christ is born. And then I was one angel. The angels, they came up and they performed. I think it was a song, glorious song. It says what? The lyric is, glory to God in the highest, on earth peace, goodwill towards men. This shepherd, they ran to the town and they tried to find this baby in the manger. And afterwards, Bible said, this man, they came out and they made widely known, right? They made widely known the saying which was told them concerning this child in verse 17. These people were filled with joy when they encountered Jesus. The other example is Jesus. When Jesus was presented to God in the temple according to the law of Moses, there are two people waiting for them. I think you guys know the names, right? Simeon and Anna. In their old ages, like especially Anna, Bible describes that she had gone through a lot in her life. But, you know, when they encountered Jesus, when they saw Jesus, finally the Messiah is here, her heart was filled with joy. I know you've been waiting for this. What about wise men? That's my favorite story. Wise men. You know, they came to Jerusalem. And if you read very carefully, they came to Jerusalem expecting that there must be some kind of celebration going on. You know, they were saying, "Where is he who has born King of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him." Matthew chapter 2, verse 2. So their heart was filled with joy. You know, they wanted to see this Messiah. When they came, you know, they saw, they met with King Herod. They had some information. When they left, they saw the star again. And the Bible said in Matthew chapter 2, verse 10, says, when they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. You see? Now, when people were drawn closer to Jesus, when they met the baby Jesus, like when they finally see this promised Messiah, people will fill with joy. We have people, you know, like a first group that I just shared, like people who are so excited about seeing Jesus. However, there's another group of people in this Christmas story who had a very different response, okay? When wise men, when they came to Jerusalem, when they saw King Herod, right? And tell him, like, "Where is the King of the Jews?" Herod responded this way in verse 3. Says, "When Herod, the king, heard this, he was," the Bible, according to the Bible, "he was" what? "Troubled. And all Jerusalem were troubled with him." Wow. I think this is very interesting. Like, you see, they were troubled. The King Herod felt troubled when he heard this Messiah coming. And not only him, but all Jerusalem, they were troubled as well. It's a Messiah. You know, the promised one. Finally, they can see something better. And now, they were troubled. It was not just worried. Everyone was trouble. What was the response of King Herod? That he was like, you know what? He was so angry. He was so mad. He sent for and put to death all the male child who were in Bethlehem in all its district from 2 years old and under. How terrible, terrible this massacre of the innocent babies. One group of people, they were filled with joy and hope from the same incident. And the other group, what? The king, especially that king, and then all people in Jerusalem, they were filled trouble. And this king reacted with rage and persecution. Wait, here. I think you've been listening very carefully. So here, you have a very interesting thing going on. First, baby, king, were principalities or power, authority, being raged, angry, killing, persecution. Does it sound familiar to you? Huh? One group of people, they were welcoming Messiah with joy. And there's the other group of people was troubled, you know, troubled because of the same news, the Christ coming. Where do you think that you can find stories like this in the Bible? I think you are guessing it right. This is from what? Book of Revelation. Book of Revelation, you can see, you know, especially the prophecy, you can see this detail, this little bit of the indicators that gives us some hints. So I want to go to Book of Revelation this morning. In the first century, this book was written for the people and the Christians in the first century where they faced a lot of challenges, okay? And I want to compare this view this morning, just briefly. First, we know that in first century Christians, they were faced a situation where everything became political. Like, we know the story from Jesus that people were under Roman Empire and they wanted to have this political freedom, right? Independence. And things were easily charged with political language. And everyone was so politically charged. Does this sound familiar to you, right? Does this sound like we're watching news these days? Cultural diversity was promoted in many different ways. You're good, everyone's good. And then you are almost forced to compromise your values because everything is good, right? This sounds familiar to you, right? And of course, we know there's a tension between Jews and Christians, and you know the citizens of Roman Empire, they didn't really like the Jewish people, and the Jewish people, they didn't really like Christians, as we know from the writings of Paul. I mean, they were just exposed to this tensions, and we know that from the history, Jewish people could figure out the final way they can coexist with the Roman Empire. But Christians, somehow they're like, we're not going to compromise. And then what? There's a result. There was a religious persecution happened. Sound very familiar to all of us. To me, what the challenges that they faced in the first century is very similar to what we face these days. They felt that there was no way out. They had to endure everything. They had to be patient. They had to find a hope in a situation where they cannot do anything about it. And the book of Revelation was given to those people as what? As a hope, right? So let's go to the book of Revelation. If you find your Bible, I want to read the first three verses in the book of Revelation chapter 1, okay? Revelation chapter 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants things which must shortly take place, and he sent signified it by his angel to his servant John, who bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, to all things that he saw. In verse 3, I want you to pay close attention to this. Blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written in it, for the time is near. Okay, here we go. It says what? Blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of this prophecy. I read this for so many times and it didn't really caught my attention. And one day I was reading and my goodness, as a pastor, somehow how can I miss this? It sounds like this, one of the Sermon on the Mounts, this beatitude, like, blessed is he. And he was specifically saying that if you read, if you hear the word of this prophecy, you will be blessed. As I was reading this passage, I'm like, to my church, like, Southview family, I'm sorry, I missed this before. You have to listen to me, but at the same time, I was talking to my church members. You have to read and you have to hear the word of God. It's because that's the guaranteed blessing for you. I assume my colleagues and pastor friends must be preaching this, the book of Revelation, to give you hope. But, this is my plea to all of you. Start reading the word of God and begin this immediately, because this is the promise from Jesus Christ himself. It's not what I promise. It's not Pastor Myung or Pastor Zeg or whoever promised. This is the promise that was given by Jesus Christ himself. We try to find joy and peace a lot from watching motivational videos from YouTube, from Facebook and the news. By the way, news is, we don't see a lot of hopeful messages these days. Anyways, but here is the one. Jesus said, read the word of prophecy and you will be blessed. And John, as he begins this book, if you go to verse 12, Revelation chapter 1, verse 12, it says, then I turned to see the voice that spoke with me. Having turned, I saw seven gold stems, and in the midst of the seven lampstands, once like the Son of Man, clothed with garment down to the feet, guarded about the chest with the golden band. His head hair were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes like a flame of the fire. His feet were like fine brass, as if refined in the furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. He had in his right hand was seven stars. Out of his mouth went the sharp sword, two-edged sword, like Hebrew chapter 4. And his countenance was like the sun shining in his strength. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. But he laid his right hand on me, saying what? Don't be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am he who lives, who was dead. Behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of Hades and of death. Write the things which you have seen, and the things which are, and the things which will take place after this. The mystery of the seven star which you saw in my right hand, and the seven gold lampstand. The seven stars are what? The angel of the seven churches. The seven lampstand which you saw are what? Seven churches. Man, I was reading this. It's like, what John saw was Jesus is, and he is presented to him as the King of the universe and glorious, and he has this power and authority to control everything. And now what? This King of the universe, he's not just far from us, but he is in the middle of the churches that he loves so much. He has interest. He is involved in his churches, right? Number seven is totality or perfection in the book of Revelation. He cares about you. He cares about God's people. He is showing that he is control of everything. A lot of times, especially when we're in the trouble, we tend to think that we are the center of the universe. You know, our perspective is everything, right? What we feel like is like, you know, when we do that, we feel like, okay, there's no solution. We feel like there's nothing we can do. We put our perspective on at the center of our universe, and we feel hopeless. But Book of Revelation, Jesus opens our eyes and showing us that it is not our perspective. This is not our universe. This is not our, you know, way of thinking. This is, you know, what it says is we are a part of God's big plan, where we can see the center of universe is not us, but the throne of God. An amazing thing is that his throne is among churches, among God's people, among all of us. And he says what? I'm not away from it. I'm there with you. I am involved with you because I love you so much. And that is the reason why we can be joyful. It's an impossible task for us to find joy in this world. We can be joyful because of Jesus Christ. Okay? We cannot be joyful because of the virus vaccine. I think it will eventually come, but we'll have another problem afterwards. You know, read Matthew chapter 24. Because, you know, we cannot be joyful because of your retirement account. We cannot be happy and rejoice because of our careers, not because of our president, not because of our country, not because of your culture, my food, your food. Those are good, but we can be only joyful because of the King of the universe. He loves you so much, and he wants to show us this big picture and his big plan, and he wants to, you know, he wants us to know that Jesus will be victorious at the end, and we will be the group of people who will be joyful, and when Jesus comes back, and we will be victorious as well eventually. That's the reason why we can be joyful. So one hymn that we all love, turn your eyes upon Jesus, right? There's no way we can find joy any other places, but we can only find joy in our Creator. And how can we find joy in our Creator? We have to see the life of Jesus and his kingdom on this earth. And how can we find joy as we see his kingdom, his life? The only way possible is what? We have to read his word. John 14:23 says this, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, or love her, my sisters. And Jesus said, we'll make our home with him. John 14:23. So this is my plea to all of my friends in greater Milwaukee metro area, that I hope you will find joy and peace as you read the Word of God, and especially the book of Revelation. I love this verse so much. Verse 3, blessed is he who reads and those who hear the word of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written in it, for the time is near. And I hope you are blessed. I hope your heart will be filled with the promise. And this is my personal plea. Just one personal note. Please treat my friend Pastor Myung well. He's a great guy. And I don't know, maybe if God's willing, I will see you guys in the future. But this is my plea to all of you. Let's read his word and read his prophecy. And let's find hope and joy in his word. Let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your words and your comfort. Lord, help us to find that deep joy and peace from your words. Please inspire our pastor friends in Milwaukee area. Help them to be inspired to teach and share this gospel to the members and Seventh-day Adventist members, and also people in Milwaukee metro area, so that people will hear your word and they can find joy and peace from your word. There must be some people who are going through difficult times, maybe because of the virus, maybe because of their job situation, the economy. Lord, I pray that you will be with them and fill them with your hope. And once again, Lord, we know that you are our Savior, you are our Creator. Please be with them, fill them with your spirit and joy. Lord, thank you so much for your promise and your love and your forgiveness and your goodness. We love you, Lord. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. May God bless you all, and I will see you guys later, if God willing.
That I'll reach glory.